Well, well, well. The last PNSO offering we got was the Giganotosaurus, and in that review, I touched on the discovery of Meraxes and how it would probably inform all future Giganotosaurus reconstructions. Lo and behold, who should we get this time but Meraxes himself, right on the heels of Lucas? Who'd have thunk it? Well, here it is. This is Mungo the Meraxes. Now, happily, unlike most other carcharodontosaurids, Meraxes has very good remains, which include an almost complete skull and forelimbs, both rarities in the clade. It was described just last year, in 2022, by Canale et al. Now, Meraxes means, well, Meraxes. In this case, it's the dragon from the Game of Thrones, and the specific name Gigas is, as we saw in Giganotosaurus, from the Greek Gigas, meaning giant. Meraxes is estimated to be 9 to 10 meters, or 30 to 33 feet long, so it's considerably smaller than Giganotosaurus estimates of 12 to 13 meters, or 39 to 42.5 feet. This model is 31 centimeters, or 12.2 inches, representing an adult of 10.8 meters, or 35.4 feet, if in the 1 to 35 scale. Here's how a human would look next to it. The most striking thing about this PNSO theropod has to be the color scheme. Now, hopefully, a start of a trend to silence future complaints and to end the beatings of chests and the gnashings of teeth. Now, this is a complete overhaul of PNSO's usual earth tones and vertical stripes. Now, we griped about earth colors. Well, now we have stone or mineral colours. We griped about the same stripes. Well, now we have forked and irregular streaks. You can see there's a lot of subtlety as expected from PNSO. Most noticeably is this very nice tinge of blue through the middle here and in other areas, as are infusions of pink, as you'll see. Now, let's get to the actual model itself, beginning as always at the head. As I explained in my Giganotosaurus video, Meraxes is delightfully one of the very rare carcharodontosaurids with very good skull remains. And between the left side and the right, we can create a composite like this. The skull is long and narrow, and there are various well-developed ridges and rugosities, which you can see in this clearer reconstruction by Dan Folks. So you have them on the nasals, the lacrimals, with the implied overlying keratin. The paper does mention a laterally projecting brow horn from the post-orbital, and here I feel that this area could perhaps be built up a little bit more. But as I always say, theropods are really a weak area of knowledge for me, so I'll leave it up to you, theropod experts, to give me your opinions below, and just some different angles of the area. Now, strangely, there seems to be a kind of shiny gloss applied, making it a little reflective from certain angles, and I don't know why that is. We have the stony colours in different shades of grey. But we also have a bit of a purplish or pinkish tinge. Now, the detail is PNSO's usual, which is to say very good, and almost feel it's a bit of a take-for-granted way to say it sometimes. The teeth are rather well painted, with some incomplete misses, though certainly better applied than in some of the older, earlier theropods. In fact, this was also the case in the previous Giganotosaurus, so I hope this is a new trend. The jaw articulates, and just like with the Giganotosaurus, opens and closes very nicely. Hopefully, another continuing trend. Now, some Chinese fans have noted, however, the discontinuity here, viewed posteriorly, but I'm quite okay to overlook this. The tongue does seem to be very starkly painted, or perhaps too much so, and hopefully this is just on mine. Other than that, the oral detail is really very good and looks like wet living tissue. As always, the eyes are important to me, and these are well painted. Though I have to say that the pupils look a little askew on mine. Now we'll look at the underside, and you can see how the pink fades in the vulnerable throat area. The paint application is really nice, and speaking of which, this is where we get to the rest of the animal. The body is a typical form we've seen in the other carcharodontosaurids. What isn't typical, however, is the pattern and color scheme. Indeed, this is so unusual for PNSO that this might actually be the main selling point for some people. You can see the tiger stripe motif. The patterns are striking enough, but what really puts it over is what PNSO does so well, which is to create subtlety in the colors, where the fades and the transitions are just so naturally applied. The general grey, of course, with the blue in the torso faded so smoothly into it. Now this infusion of blue is also seen in the arms, the thighs, and the tail. And you'll see echoes of it elsewhere too. And as for the stripes, just look at the beauty of the area here. Now you already have a very nice background fade from the grey to the blue. But then the stripes themselves experience their own fade on top of that. There's no starkness of colour that makes it look painted on. And every stripe and streak looks like subcutaneous pigment. The entire presentation is so naturalistic and, dare I say, soothing to look at, which is ironic, given its presence on such a dangerous animal. There's an almost whitish-grey to the dorsal that's almost like a highlight. And now the legs. You can see the detail, of course, that we've gotten used to from PNSO. And down to the feet. Interesting point in the feet is the second toe. Now this second toe doesn't have just a relatively enlarged angle. There's also what's described as a moderately sharp ventral edge here, while the rest have a rounded surface. Now this is mentioned almost in passing in the paper, so if anyone knows more about this, please comment below. But it's nice that PNSO has actually done the research and included this little detail here. Speaking of detail, here on the underside, then the last look at the tail. And now we get to the arms. Now the arms of Meraxes deserve a little bit more of mention later on, but for now, notice how small they are. In fact, for some of you, this might even give you tyrannosaurid or abelisaurid vibes. They're of course sculpted with the same kind of meticulous care that PNSO would give to a more prominent region. But in fact, as we'll see, these arms are pretty cool and interesting. This comes with the mandatory support stand, but like most of the other PNSOs, it will stand on its own, at least for a while. It's always nice how PNSO manages to balance its pteropods while still having a realistic pose without clown feet. If the feet were made of harder material that wouldn't warp, it would be fantastic. Alright, let's talk a little about those little arms. Now we all know of the very small but functional arms in the tyrannosaurids, and of the very small and possibly useless arms of the abelisaurids. I've mentioned before that these are a super important point of interest for me, and I usually skip models just on the size or proportion inaccuracies of the arms. the forelimbs of carcharodontosaurids are generally poorly known, as you can see from the material of Carcharodontosaurus, Mapusaurus, Tyrannotitan. But even from these remnants, as well as the happily complete Acrocanthosaurus forelimbs, we've known that they were rather small. But it wasn't until Meraxes, which preserves almost complete forelimbs, that we realized just how diminutive they could get on a Carcharodontosaurid. The arm is only about 47% the length of the femur, and this ratio is actually comparable to the later Tyrannosaurids and Abelisaurids. In fact, Canale et al. Plotted the femur length here on the x-axis, and then the forelimb femur length ratio on the y-axis. Note that this is a log scale. And you see that the Abelisaurids, the Tyrannosaurids, and the Carcharodontosaurids actually cluster around here. Because all three lineages have such similar degrees of arm reduction, Canale et al. Postulate that there's a lower limit to the forelimb to femur ratio of about 0.4. This limit is seen not just in these three clades of larger animals, but also smaller dinosaurs such as Mononychus and Limosaurus. And the amount of forelimb shortening doesn't correlate with how robust they were. You know, for example, that Tyrannosaurids and Abaresaurids have robust, well-muscled forelimbs, while those of the Abelisaurids were pretty much useless. The reason suggested for this minimum limit is interesting: the retention of the scapular muscles. Now have a look here. At this T-Rex, you notice that in spite of the tiny arms, the scapular coracoid is still relatively large. That's also the case with Meraxes here, and most of all, here in Carnotaurus. Now, scapulae have muscles which must attach somewhere on the arm. If you've studied anatomy, you'll no doubt have seen diagrams like this when you were trying to learn muscle origins and insertions. Well, if you consider some of the muscles that probably arose on the scapula, are seen here in red from Birch 2017 for Mungosaurus. They have to insert somewhere on the humerus. And to do that, the humerus must be of a minimum size to accommodate those insertions, seen here in blue. And if other muscles originate from the humerus itself, as you see in red, then that itself requires more surface area, and hence sufficient size. There have always been plenty of speculation about the use of these proportionately tiny limbs. Now, some people assign functions like reproductive behavior or helping the animal rise from prone. Others consider them vestigial of limited or no use. And a third approach is to separate the function in different animals and instead focus on the commonality in evolutionary processes that may have convergently caused this reduction, for example, an increase in the size of the head. And this is what Canale et al. Suggests, and actually is what I've always assumed to be the case. In other words, it's not a question of what these arms evolved to be used for. It's more a case of these arms being reduced as a common consequence of something else, say skull size, and from there, what they could still be used for. Apparently, in some clades, it could still be used for something, and in others, they became vestigial and useless. Now, some comparisons. The first is my wild safari Giganotosaurus. I mentioned this before in my favorite safaris video. The tiger stripe pattern is a favorite of mine. Here, the Meraxes has, of course, a similar motif. And I actually wish that the PNSO Giganotosaurus that came before would have had this paint application, while the Giga's paint job could have gone into the Meraxes. And that would really have been a nice touch for me, but there would doubtless be critics making snide remarks of the fine line separating homage and plagiarism. Then, of course, PNSO's other Carcharodontosaurids. The most obvious comparison would be the most recent Giganotosaurus, which owes some of its skull reconstruction to Meraxes. And here you can see some obvious similarities in the skull. In a sense of fair exchange, they've even given the Meraxes somewhat of a Giganotosaurus chin. They look really good together. Then we have PNSO's Carcharodontosaurus, the namesake of the clade, I've always liked the Carcharodontosaurus paint application, though it's not a sentiment that some other collectors have. But the subtlety of fading that you see in PNSO's pteropods, well, this one was one of the first. You can also see the advancement in detail in the soles. Then, here's the other unusually painted Carcharodontosaurid, the Acrocanthosaurus. And here you see what PNSO could really do if they wanted to give an animal a different paint and pattern scheme. Indeed, the Acrocanthosaurus was possibly my favourite PNSO pteropod paint job. Oh, before I forget, some of you might want to look at the Eofaunus Giganotosaurus as well. And finally, the PNSO Wilson, just for a size comparison. So let's have all the PNSO Carcharodontosaurids together. Now we can see how PNSO has really helped to flesh out this clade, and it's easy to see how with time, PNSO could possibly offer us the wider selection of animals to fill in the pteropod phylogeny of any company. And it's going to be glorious, especially for pteropod lovers. I do hope, however, that we'll get a non-pteropod soon. I'm dying to know what else PNSO will be applying their latest sculpting and paint technique to. So, that's it from me. As always, please let me know what you think, and I'll see you in the next video.